us from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Oh, wanderer, come home, you're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are. There's hope for the hopeless and all those who've strayed. Come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. Sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay
slowly, by the way.
Yeah, but so her excuse right at the end. Yeah, as long as Gary is
looking good,
then Michael.
More mobile app.
Maybe midnight or midday, never early, never late. He gon' stand by what he claimed. Lived enough life to save.
I heard your heart.
Maybe midnight or midday, it's never early.
There's a seat at the table just waiting for you. So come on inside. I'm tired of feeling like I'm a million miles away from where I began. Doing my best to keep up. Sure, I had good intentions, but I got lost along the way. I don't want to waste any more of my life. Looking to the left, looking to the right. So now I'm coming back to you. Consume me with your love. Set my heart. To the camp where I gave you my life.
Where I gave you my life.
And even though yesterday seemed so far away, I know you're still by my side.
Away. Well, good morning and welcome. Let's stand together and worship and just have a good time celebrating his awesomeness. Let's sing it together. That he's done for us this morning. Come on.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Sing it out.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Come on.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, it's His amazing grace. This is a failing love. That You would take my place. That You would bear my cross. You lay down Your life.
rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. Us up on wings like eagles,
joining us online and you don't have your bread and your juice or whatever, you're going to share communion with us and go ahead and grab that. And here at Bayside, we practice an open communion table. And so all who believe in Jesus Christ, yeah, please go ahead. All who believe in Christ, if you've accepted him as your Lord and Savior, you are welcome to share in communion with us. So a lot of you know, I have one, thank you. A lot of you know, we got a new puppy this week. And oh my gosh, he's so much fun. He's 9 weeks old, little Australian Shepherd. And as you can imagine, if you have dogs, everything in our household right now is influenced by this little puppy. Because he just, that's how he is. He takes up so much space and energy and attention and laughter. Oh my gosh, it's so much fun. But it's completely shaped how we do life. And I'm thinking, as I'm playing with my little puppy this morning, isn't that how we're to be as believers? That everything we do is shaped by the cross. Because we stand in the shadow of that cross as Christians. And when I think about, here we are, it's technically Easter season. And when you read the stories after the resurrection of how Jesus appeared to his disciples, you would think, right, as modern day people, he'd be like, ha, I told you, and you should have believed me, and look, I'm triumphant, I did it. But he doesn't do that. He shows up and he meets them at their point of greatest need. He shows up when Mary's weeping because the tomb is empty and she doesn't know where he is. And he says, I'm here. He shows up when the two disciples are walking on the road to Emmaus, and the scripture says their faces were so sad and downcast. I mean, they're devastated. And he shows up and walks with them. And he doesn't say, shame on you for not believing. No, he reveals himself and has a meal with them. He shows up when the disciples are out fishing. And in a beautiful story that circles right back to when he first met some of them, he gives them a great catch of fish and shares a meal. Jesus shows up. The resurrected Christ shows up at our point of greatest need. And the reason he can do that is the power of the cross. And so as we get prepared to share communion this morning, this is the same meal he shared with his disciples Thursday before he was betrayed. That exact same representation of that meal in the cup and in the bread of Christ, representing his body and representing his blood. And so I want to encourage you to go ahead and peel off your little top of your cup here if you're here on campus. And take out that wafer, because this represents the body of Christ. And the beautiful thing about communion, it's such a sacred moment. Like, this has been handed down through time, directly through from Jesus. And he's here with us right now, on campus, online. Christ is here because of his sacrifice. So on the night he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he said, this is my body. Whenever you eat this, do this in remembrance of me. Let's take the bread. In the same way, he took the cup, and he said, this cup represents the new covenant. This is my blood poured out for you. This new covenant is this new relationship of forgiveness and redemption for all sin. It's going to come through Christ's sacrifice. This cup is the blood of that. Take this cup in remembrance of me. God, we're so grateful that you reach through time, through the sharing of communion. You're as present today with us through the power of the Holy Spirit as you were with those disciples that night. God, we're so grateful for your grace, for your forgiveness, for your kindness. And so, Lord, we share this cup, we share this bread in remembrance of you. And God, may you be glorified through us. In your holy name, amen. Thank you.
is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh,
name of this song is called Come to the Altar. Altars represent a place where we encounter God, in which it's a place of meeting, it's a place of that sacred. And even though we don't have an altar, we have access to one. You know that, right? You don't have to physically have a place, though we are in a place. And I'll tell you just something that's been on my heart just throughout the week. And we're going to pray a moment and with our service. But it's been a while since we talked a little bit about Ukraine and the condition of the world and stuff that are happening. And I got a message from a friend of mine, and people like Pastor Peter, who's continuing to deal with the refugee situation. And there's a lot of voices that are trying to stir a lot of fear. And certainly in the human element, there's a lot of things that we could recoil from. But you got to understand one thing. There is a God. He is in heaven, and he is in absolute control of human history. And there is no one human personality or person that can derail that. Huh? We want to put God on our terms, which is a human level. And he is God who is sovereign. And I've said this before. He is the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. And the reason why I'm saying that this morning is that we as a company of people need to understand that wherever there's crisis and conflict, though God in a fallen world hasn't created any of that, he is a God whose heart is turned to the oppressed and the broken and the suffering. And he hears the cry of his people. How many of you believe that? So I'm going to ask if we could just this morning, if you just take your right hand and just do this with me. Jesus, there is so much suffering going on in the world. And our brothers and sisters in the Ukraine and in Russia and various places and all the struggle that is going on. Lord, as a people, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. It's your kingdom. Lord, we pray for peace. We pray for intervention, Lord God. We pray for the stoppage of the suffering and the pain that's going on. And Lord, we just ask that in every situation that you would come and hear the cry of your people, Lord, and do what only you could do as God, the one true God. And we ask, Jesus, that you would intervene in the suffering and the pain, and that you would cease war. You would cease this in your name, in Jesus' name. If you agree with that, can you just say amen? Thank God for God. Huh? And you know what else I thank God for? That I'm not God and you're not God. So we don't have to play God, huh? Hey, why don't we take a moment? There's a bunch of wonderful people here on May 1st. Can you believe it? It's May already. Huh? How time's traveling. Turn around to a few people and say, I don't know what it is, but you look like spring has kicked in. Go ahead.
Oh, kicked in.
I kicked in. Yeah. Morning. Hey, by the way, just an exciting bit of news. Our church got donated a new coffee machine that's been refurbished. So Char and the team that's in there, I think it's Sarah Satterfield, we got a machine that really puts the coffee out. Can you say thank you, Jesus? Some of you are raising your coffee cups. And welcome Colleen Johnson, who is our director of CR, and the one and only Jeremy McKnight.
Hey, before we go any further, just one second. The Burger Bash last week, before you do the connection card, how many of y'all went to the Burger Bash last week? It was a good time, right? Woo! Lots of fun. I got to serve with somebody. I know a lot of people were involved, and they did a great job. But Chris, can you? Yeah, there he is right there. See him raising? Chris made all the burgers by hand. It was amazing. He went out and got the meat and did it all. So I know a lot of people were involved, and I want to overshine those people, but it was amazing to work with Chris. He was a great servant last week.
No punchline?
Not everything's a joke, Al, right?
That must be a first.
No, my dad would tell me that. Not everything's a joke, Jeremy. It's just okay.
All right, we're going to have some therapy. Turn around. We're going to have... But, hey, we want to welcome you this morning. And if you are new to us, both online and in person, there is a connection card in the seat. We ask that you pull that connection card out during the offering. You can fill out your information. If you have a prayer request, we'd like to do. We pray over those prayer requests, and please, it'll help us help you.
And ushers, you can go ahead and come forward. Your faithfulness in offering it and giving is what helps us to continue to serve our community and to love our community well. And there's various ways that you can give, obviously in person here, but you can also give with our online app. Our drop-down menu there to our general fund or any of our ministries or missions. And you can also text us, I believe, to give as well. And that should be on a slide here in a moment. But if you would join me in prayer for the offering, please. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your faithfulness, for our generosity, or the generosity that is bestowed upon us, and the opportunity and privilege to bless our community. We pray that you'll multiply this offering, Father, and that we can use it to love our community well. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And hey, ladies, by the way, we have a great event coming up for you. It is our Ladies Paint Night, and that is Saturday, May 14th from 6 to 8 p.m. in the cafe. And let me tell you, you don't have to have any experience or talent. Can I say that? We have a professional that's going to tell us exactly what to do. It's $30, and that $30 covers all the supplies, including refreshments and a charcuterie tray. So be sure you register because space is limited. It's going to fill up really fast.
Yes, and also coming up May 15th, fun for the whole family after church. We're going to be doing a Gold Rush whodunit mystery, the gosh-awful gold pouch mystery, an interactive entertainment set in the Gold Rush era. It's fun for the whole family, and if you know a family or maybe grandparents that are raising grandchildren, something where maybe these kids don't attend church or a family doesn't come, this is a great time for them to come, be a part of our community, get to meet some people, and just a fun, non-threatening environment. We ask that you dress up in a couple weeks in Western wear to really get into it. There's supposed to be a character here today, Uncle Fuzzy.
I think so.
Who's going to be dressed in garb, kind of promoting the thing, so... If you see him, say hello. I got 1,000 jokes about it, but none of them are appropriate for church, so it's a real problem. But this will be a great time for families to come together and just hang out and get to just to bond a little bit more. It's a really great idea. I'm glad we're doing more stuff like this after church and just getting to hang out. So please remember, dress in Western wear, May 15th after church. Food will be provided. There's going to be pony rides and gold panning. It's a whole thing. So please come by.
Great job. And last but not least, on May 22nd, we are going to have a baptism class, a water baptism class. If you're interested, we have many people that have received Christ through the Easter season. So at 9 o'clock, we're going to have a class, and then we are going to do some water baptisms on May 22nd. We don't want to wait. We believe that it's as people receive Christ, we want to make it available. And so please put that on the calendar, and you can let one of the pastors know, or you could text us, and we'll be prepared for you.
That was admirable restraint on Jeremy's part. So I get to read the passage of scripture that Pastor Al is going to preach through. And I'm going to be honest, this is a hard passage. And so I really want to encourage you, if you're here on campus, if you're joining us online, stick with us. Because I really pray that you hear the Lord's heart behind the passage and through the message. So stick with us through the entire sermon. And I'm actually going to back up and start at verse 16. Because this is what happens right before. And it says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." So that includes all of us. "For in it the righteousness of God is revealed, from faith for faith, as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith." And now the passage for today. "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world, in the things that have been made. So they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him. But they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. Therefore, God gave them up in the lust of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them up to dishonorable passions. For their women exchanged natural relations for those that are contrary to nature. And the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another, men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but give approval to those who practice them."
Today I'm dealing with a passage that is both challenging and redemptive. But before we jump into the passion, I want you to know my heart after hours of prayer, looking into my own life and my own need for grace, as well as my calling as a pastor teacher. Allow me to give you three things this morning that directs my preaching. First, I'm submitted to the Bible being the inspired word of God, which is God revealing his purpose and plan for mankind. I do not worship the book, but rather the living Christ who has revealed himself through this book. Though I'm informed by culture around me, it is not culture that defines the truth for me. Second, I'm committed to grounding the truth of Scripture in history. The American church has been notorious of redefining all sorts of doctrines and have at times redefined certain things in a way that has suited them. And at times, the church has been known as being unloving and unkind. For instance, their culture would say that if I have to say, as a believer, that I disagree with something, that that makes me unloving. And that's not true. The most loving thing you could do is to courageously tell the truth in love, but at the same token, not do it arrogantly. The position of arrogance has not set the church up straight when talking about difficult topics like we're talking about this morning. And I do not preach this message with a finger pointed rather than with an open hand. Finally, I come humbly as a pastor who loves the people that I have honored to serve. And in my exploration of this passage, I have recognized my own need for grace. A grace that not just I encountered years ago when I came to Christ, but a grace that I must live out every day in my life as a mortal man. So let's get started. What's the story behind the story? In order to understand the passage that we have to understand the man Paul. We have to understand Paul's resume. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 12 through 15 gives us the backdrop, the story to this context that embeds Paul's resume and the power of grace and why grace was so meaningful to Paul. Look what he says. I thank him who has given me strength, Christ Jesus our Lord, because he judged me faithful, appointing me into his service, though formerly I was, can you repeat these with me, blasphemer, persecutor, an insolent opponent. Quite a resume, huh? But I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with love, with faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. He's the chief. He's the GOAT. The greatest of all time, he's saying. I'm the chief of all sinners. Paul, in his theology, for every church that he preached into, every message that he gave, he was completely gripped by mercy and grace. So let's look at the key verses to this passage. Betsy, Pastor Betsy read this, but it sets the stage for where we're going with this passage. Paul says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the righteousness shall live by faith. Now there are two important words that we will see throughout the book of Romans. And we have to define these two words. First is the gospel. It's the good news. Guess what it means? Write this down. Good news. You can't add to it. What's the good news? The good news is that in all of history, and we're going to discuss it in a few moments, in the pantheon of all the religions of the world, Jesus Christ came to do the one thing that we could not do, that was to appease the wrath of God. He came, he suffered, he died for one purpose in mind. It is the good news. There is no qualifier. It is not bad news, though some has treated it as such. It's good news. And then there's the whole topic of faith. Pisto, the verb, pistu. There's a noun and a verb form of this. Faith is interwoven. So what does he mean by faith? You might want to write this down. Faith is simply when you trust enough about something, when you trust enough about something that you act on it. That you act on it. That's what faith is. That you act on it. You simply act on your faith. Now, let me give you an illustration of this to kind of, how many of you believe that you should eat right? You should eat a healthy diet. That's why I've seen some of you at In-N-Out, because you're practicing that. Protein style, there you go. How many of you believe you should exercise regularly? All right. How many of you do that consistently? A few of you. See, in our culture, we treat faith like optimism. I'm optimistic about something, and we equate that with faith. And what the biblical notion of how Paul uses this word is faith is something that you trust. We put our trust in Christ, that we act on that faith. It's not just an optimism. It's not just a hope that says, well, you know what? Maybe next week I'm going to exercise or do whatever it is. Faith is you act on that which you place your trust in. Now, here's how why we desperately need Jesus. And this is the first point I make. We become what we worship. This whole passage is about idolatry. It's about what are we going to worship? What are we going to worship? Look what he says. For the wrath of God is revealed, and I want you to catch this. This is present tense. Paul's not talking about, he's not talking about something that just simply happened in the past. He's saying right now, the wrath of God is being revealed. And you know what the wrath of God is revealed as? It's abandonment. It's distance from God. It's that lack of connection with God. From heaven against all ungodliness. I want you to catch this. Say all ungodliness.
All ungodliness.
We're going to get back to that. And unrighteousness. Of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world. Or in God's order, God's consciousness, how he saw things, in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. So what Paul is saying is there's a big, great debate. What happens if you're on an island in the middle of nowhere and you didn't know Jesus? Are you held to the same standard? Well, it's called general revelation. What Paul is saying, that when you look at the created order of things, that when you look at human beings, psychologists don't even know how to define it other than this. We know there's a God consciousness and that there's an awareness of an all-powerful creator. We know that. It's embedded in all people. It's embedded in all cultures. We have an awareness that there is a divine order to things. Now, some people have tried to say, well, it's the God part of the brain that believes this way. Or it's just who we are. We are part of his creation. And so Paul's saying you can't plead ignorance. You can't plead ignorance because God has shown through his power and his majesty throughout his created order that he's God. Now, the key word that I want to really set here is the word all. All ungodliness and righteousness. Who, me? Come on, Al. Is he talking about me? All unrighteousness. But wait a second, Al. Certainly when I showed up this morning, you greeted me in the parking lot, and you know that it has to deal with somebody else. It's the guy in the left corner in the fifth row. It can't be me. It's all unrighteousness. But to understand what he's saying here, let's look behind the curtain. I want you to catch this. Paul is dealing with Roman and Greek culture that all believed in a polytheistic set of gods. And these gods were embedded in the culture of the day. One set of these gods are known as the Furies. And the Furies were these wrathful gods. And there's a whole set of them. I'm not going to lecture you on just all of them that were in this pantheon. But when they were upset with humanity, and humanity was somehow disobeying them, this is where the mythos got created in culture that if a person was sick, it was one of the gods that made him sick. If a person was all of a sudden impoverished, it was one of the gods. Why? Because the sacrifice or the propitiation had to be made by man. Man had to suffer for the propitiation of sin. That was throughout all of the religions of the day. So when Paul is preaching this, he's literally coming at this in a very opposite approach to say, Jesus Christ has a different way of doing this. He's not laying the need or demand of propitiation or righteousness on you unless you choose to take control of it. And we'll get to that point of how we do that. But I want you to capture the backdrop of that. That God is not just about love, but he actually has wrath. He hates sin. And he hated sin so much, what did he do? He said, I've got to give a resolution to sin in a way that man cannot. And he gave Jesus Christ to appease his wrath. I'm not laying that on humanity. I'm doing it myself. I'm appeasing my own wrath. I'm going to nerd out on you a little bit. Is that okay? If you don't get this, you won't get the rest of this message. The challenge is, when we deal with hard truths, they develop soft people. What do I mean by that? The heart has an increased capacity for the truth, and we can authentically love God and love others when we have to deal with things that are very, very hard. Thinking about how you grew up. Tell me about all the things that transformed your heart or got you to a situation that sensitized you. I guarantee you that the number one thing was it was always a difficult circumstance. There are challenges that shape us, that take the residue of our heart and those things and says, listen, I want to shape you. Now, soft truths create hard people. The heart shrinks. And arrogance creates an inability to love well. And then it becomes about not sacrifice, but selfishness. And Paul is saying, listen, if we're going to deal with this thing called wrath, as we obey God, as we lean into him, as we give him our allegiance, not just a faith that says, I think I'm going to do that, but a faith that lives it out, not because we need to earn it, but because we love God so much, what happens is God says, listen, I'm carrying the brunt of this stuff. So before I go on any further, God has a wrath. He doesn't like sin. And we ought not like sin too, because the last time I checked, most of Al Soto's issues that have been long-term and short-term have been because of things that I have to say, God, I got to lean into you for these things. Now, am I the only one here that has those issues? Good, I think I can finish this message today. I'm in a good group of people, and for those who are online. Now, catch this. Let's look at how a culture crumbles in the five steps downward that he looks at this passage. And the first step is they ignored God in verse 21. And you might want to write this down. Here's the big thought. If we want nothing to do with God, he will grant us our wish. He'll grant us our wish. God, I want nothing to do with you. I want to live on my own terms. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him. But they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Why do we ignore God? What causes humanity to want to ignore God? We ignore God because we want to avoid his moral standard. We desire to live without restraint. Come on, let's be honest here. How many of you, when you were younger, prayed that your parents would go on a long vacation? And why did you pray that your parents would go on a long vacation? If they were gone, guess what? There are no boundaries. But how? It can't be. That's the way we are. That's the way we are. That's the reason why on the job, when some of you want to do something that you know that is out of order, what's the first thing you do? Who's watching? Who's seeing me? And what Paul is saying here is you got to catch this. He's saying that they knew God, but they weren't going to honor him. Why? Because they were futile. They got to the place of their thinking that they said, you know what, God, somehow we're smarter than you. And we could figure this out. Now, before we go there, understand that all sin is kind of embedded with that. To miss the mark, which is what sin means, literally, to miss his mark, literally means we choose our own way. We miss it. And how many times can any of you remember that before you did something that you knew was wrong, you talked yourself into doing it anyways? Huh? We just kind of went, yeah, blah, 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 blah. That happened to me when I was a kid. I think I told the story a long time ago, one time before. But across the street, we had Restivo Egg Farm. We knew we weren't supposed to play with matches. But there is nothing better than burning spiders with model glue and matches. And in the middle of it, we're having a discussion, the three of us. We ought not be doing this. This could get out of control. And guess what? The barn caught on fire. Yes. Yes. That was a day that Al came to know the wrath of Dad at a level that I never knew. But I knew it, and I still did it. I knew we shouldn't be doing this. And if we're really thoughtful about this, there is something that says, I don't want to live with restraint. And that's what Paul is saying. They've come to the place where they say, I don't want restraint. And then here's the second step. We redefine God. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. But Al, okay, I get the ancient custom where they would get a chicken and say, that's going to be my God or whatever, an image of something. How do we do it today? Well, we do it today. Let me tell you how we do it. We make up our own mental redefinitions of God. We redefine God not based on Scripture, but what we think God ought to be. And he's saying, listen, the second step of the downward spiral is you, for some of us, we create God, maybe, in our own image. God, you must be a lot like me. You must be just more like human being than deity. There's a lot of ways that we do this, but Paul is saying that's the second step of this downward spiral. We begin to redefine who God is. And I got to tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. This is the reason why it is so scary of what is happening. Don't even talk about the world, what's happening in the church today. When I hear talk that, well, you know, he's not really the sovereign God. He's a God that has limited ability. That's some of the discussion that's going on. God isn't the complete sovereign. No, he is the sovereign God. Amen. He is the creator of the universe. Now, step three, set aside all sexual restraints. Now, before I jump in this, let me kind of say this. In order to understand this passage, you have to understand Romans 8. So let me be clear with this. Romans 8, Easter Sunday, all creation groans for its redemption. I don't understand, ladies and gentlemen. All I can tell you is this, that before the fall, there was perfection. Man falls, rebellion kicks in, and even the very fabric of creation itself feels the effects of the fall. That goes all the way down to genetics. It goes around to everything. We have sickness. We have disease. We have things that occur as a result of a fallen, broken world. All creation is broken and experiences this scientific term, this one of the laws of thermodynamics, entropy. Entropy is all matter deteriorates. Now, I hate to tell you that. You can buy all the retinol you want. Your skin is going to age. Right? I could go to Bath and Body Works and get everything I want. And I like it, by the way, because if you want to smell good, that's good. But I'm going to age. I am not 30 anymore. There is entropy. That is part of the law that kicked in after the fall. Now, why is that important? Well, we look at the passage. Therefore, God gave them up to the lusts of their heart. And I want you to circle this word to sexual impurity. Before I go on any further, people will read this passage, and the only thing that will bounce out is the discussion around homosexuality. But I want to define sexual impurity. We don't just talk about this a lot in the church. This isn't the thing that's the pickup that every pastor goes, I signed up for that. Let's talk about this topic. But it's necessary. And out of 40 years of pastoral ministry, I have sat through the brokenness of a culture that does not want restraint in the area of human sexuality and has become a form of idolatry. So before I go on any further, let me give you, I'm going to skip the slide a little bit, so bear with me. From the heart of a pastor dealing with sexual impurity, let me give you two things. First, we have used the secular to redefine the sacred. I hope there's no kids in here. I'm not going to be real crass or anything, but I want to make sure if you're online, you might want to say, hey, Johnny, Susie, go watch whatever they watch at this time. But I want you to hear the heart of this pastor, because this is so important. I had a gentleman in San Jose who railed me. And some of you are not aware of this, but we called it the upheaval of the 80s, the moral upheaval of the 80s. Here's how the church handled it. Group of pastors, about 100 of them, got together and said, we're going to go down to downtown San Jose, and we're going to protest the LGBTQ community. And it was awful, the signs that were there, the words that were being used. I chose not to go. This man railed me. Pastor, you don't want to stand on your convictions. And I said, that wasn't the point at all. I said, I have a difficult time. Jesus would be out there with a sign. Why wouldn't he be out there having conversations and loving people? And listen, the scripture is clear. We're going to get into the passage. It's clear that God is saying there is a created order to things, and I'm going to get to it with man and woman. There's no questioning the passage with that in terms of how God creates this thing. But what we've done is we've taken an elevated one sin, and then heterosexuals, we can get away with anything. This man's blasting me. 3 weeks later, I get a phone call. The police are at his house, because he had just terrorized his family. And this same man had gone off and had two affairs with two other women. Guess what Pastor Al got to do? Until 11 o'clock that night, I was with his little kids, having to comfort them while he's being taken away, because his lust had gotten to the point of anger and rage that he was ready to take it out on his family. His kids didn't ask for that. We live in a culture, let's be this honest. Al, the covenant of marriage, that's just a paper, right? I mean, come on. God really, really wants us to exercise our sexuality. And here's the challenge when we have these conversations. It's called the moral high ground. Most of us probably didn't live that way before Jesus. And so we struggle. We struggle with, with that whole thing of covenant relationship and what it means and how we need to honor some people. And then if you preach something like that, oh, golly, those Christians are such a prude and they make God to be a prude. Obviously, you know, I don't want to serve that kind of God. And by the way, God created sex. And it's sacred. And it's not a cultural notion. It's a gift that he's given mankind. And it's beautiful within the covenant of marriage relationship. But we live in a culture that has redefined this. There isn't a show on TV. And I'm not here to point the finger at what programs you watch. But you know, as well as I know, that the fidelity of relationships are all over the map. Listen. I'm just going to be this honest. Before I came to Jesus, I didn't do everything right. And then I met my bride, and I wanted to do it right. And it was hard. And I had accountability. But I wanted somehow to, one day, I had a picture in my mind, because my family was so fractured, I wanted to be able to look at my sons and my grandkids and say, after Jesus, I tried to do it right. I took a stand. That's where grace comes in. So there's no hammer here. This isn't a God that says, hey, you blew it before, we're going to zap you. That's not God. In the same token, if I know God, I'm accountable to the level of the truth that I know to be true. And I can make the choice today to say, God, I'm going to live this out with you. Not because God's a prude, but because he created this wonderful gift. And the brokenness of our culture, if we're really honest, our human sexuality has rifted us on so many different levels. Would you agree with me? To the point that parents no longer feel like they can even have the conversation because there's so much shame in their relationship. They feel like, I mean, I'm not the one who can do that. And I have this happen to me. Go talk to Matt Moorcraft. Go talk to Pastor Al. They'll help you. No. We all live under the same grace. It was what? All unrighteousness. And what I'm telling you as a church, and hear the heart of this pastor, if we honor God in our human sexuality, if we say, God, I want to honor it your way, there is blessing and there's wholeness and there is grace. Now, we did it wrong in the past too. We had a purity culture that was going to force everything on everybody, but we never gave the why behind it. I was going through a book with my kids one time, and I'll never forget this. My son, Michael, who's really smart, and he was always the one that would ask the questions. I remember one night, I'm getting him ready for bed, and he says this, Dad, can I ask you a question? Sure, son. Do you and Mom have sex? I immediately began to speak in tongues. No, I'm joking. I'll never forget the moment as long as I live. I said, God, give me the words because I want to give the right words. I said, where did you hear this? All the kids were in the schoolyard. We're talking about it. And I wanted to ask you. And it was like the Holy Spirit. Because I'm not that smart. It just kind of infused me. It just went like this. Boom. I said, son, what your mom and I have is not just sex. It's love. And here it is. We make love. And I got to bring in the thing about Jesus and everything. And this is what Michael goes, that's really cool, Dad. Can I go to sleep now? Secondly, where we die to self and obey Jesus in is the greatest weapon of our warfare generationally. I live in a family system that we're not very committed. There's a lot of brokenness and a lot of pain. And in our sexuality, there is a blessing that comes as we walk it out. And for us who may have had brokenness in that, as God heals us in that and we walk in a new way, there's generational blessing in that for our kids and our grandkids. There are things that we get to say no to because God has given us the capacity to say, listen, I'm going to stay within the boundaries of what God says, because all sexuality outside of God's design can become a form of idolatry. All unrighteousness. Now listen, hear me again. Al, I didn't get it right. I failed. I have brokenness. Okay, I get it. This is where we lean into Jesus, and there's grace. So don't walk away going, man, this preacher is just kind of... No, listen. God has a standard because he loves us so much. He wants what's best for us. He's not a prude. He's not an angry God. And he's certainly not a God that comes up with a bad hair day like you and I do. Huh? Thank God for that. But he's a God who lovingly works with us. Now look at this. Al... So I'm going to say this. For some of you that only see one sin, I'm going to be very clear with this. Just as God loves everybody, God does not hate the LGBTQ community. I don't understand. I'm not a geneticist. I do of why people make choices and live out the way that they live. I just know this, that we all have appetites in a broken world, and you need to be deeply grateful that my appetite, which is a propensity for drinking, that I'm not exercising that freedom right now. Because there'd be some of you in El Dorado County that would applaud being drunk as being okay, or being a drunkard. We live in a culture that says it's okay. You want to get blasted, it's fine. Not for me. I can't. And what I do know is that in a broken, fallen world, God sets boundaries because he loves us. And as I die to certain appetites, as difficult as it may be, and I don't understand all these things, that we honor God and that God, by his grace, does what he does in our lives. Comprendo? That's Greek for comprendo. So in our church, we've had a group of people that have been discussing how we're going to love our community. And I'm going to tell you this, and I'm pleased to say this. We have people that are exploring faith, that are here, that love Jesus. And they're on this journey, and they are welcomed. But I want you to also understand this, that our conviction to certain things in the scripture, as narrow as they may seem, as I anchor them that way, remember I said hard truths make you give you a soft heart, actually allow us to love broadly. Amen. We have a biblical statement on biblical sexuality. We believe in the historical Christian view of marriage and sexual expression, namely that marriage is one flesh covenant union between two sexually different persons, male and female, from different families, and that all sexual relationships outside of the marriage covenant are sin. Notice what it says, all. So it's not one sin. All outside of marriage is sin. Now, I want to say this. I'm going to say it again. This isn't a one-bullet pony just about LGBTQ community or that. It's all of us saying, Jesus, am I going to take what you have given me as a gift, and am I going to steward that according to your purpose and your plan? Which leads to the fourth one. It's coming. Step four, set aside all relational restraints. Look what he says. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice, and they are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents. Ooh, I didn't know that was there. Huh? Foolish, faithless, heartless, and ruthless. Can I tell you this? John Bass did a great job with Words Matter, and he defined all these. I'm not going to have the opportunity this morning or the time to go through every word. He did a great job with that. But can I give you a big thought? When God is out of the picture, I attempt to become God, and I have no mercy for others. I have no mercy for others. I begin to lie, because lying is what I do to my enemies when I don't want to be honest. I begin to slander people, because somehow I have some kind of hate in my heart, and so it's easier for me to slander something about you and talk about you. I begin to become full of envy. If something good happens in your life, I don't want to be out for whatever's good in your life. And I get consumed with envy. Al, you mean to tell me that this behavior, when you choose to distance yourself from the wisdom of God, that you can get to this place? Absolutely. You could even believe that gossip is a spiritual gift, I guess. And we look at this list and we go, wow, really? And then it leads to step five in this downward spiral. He says they not only no longer have relational restraints, but here's step five. They promote and celebrate sin. Here's the big thought here. The formerly shameful becomes a source of pride. What we used to be ashamed of now becomes a point of pride. But I want to say it again. The wrath of God is revealed against what? All unrighteousness. All unrighteousness. So let me, it's not them. It's us. It's me. All unrighteousness. Let me give you three lessons that I want to give you this morning. First, this isn't a list to show us why everyone else needs Jesus. It's meant to show us why we need Jesus.
That's right. Amen.
Jesus has given us incredible good news. And the list of sins, sometimes we'll treat them as a red light and a green light. Let me kind of explain to you. When we read this passage, here's what we see. They're the highlighted red ones. For their women exchanged natural relationships for those that are contrary to nature. Men likewise gave up their natural relations with women and were consumed with the passion with one another. Then we see murder and, oh, those haters of God, those people on the other side of the political spectrum that are just trying to rob me of everything, they're haters of God. Oh, well, yeah, that sin, I'm going to land there. That's a big red one. Huh? But then there's the green. Look at the green. There's the green verses. And the green sins are the ones that they get overlooked. Unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice, envy, strife, deceit, maliciousness, gossip, slanders, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish faithfulness, heartless, ruthless. And when I look at this list, maybe the question we ought to be asking is this, ladies and gentlemen. Not that I'm no longer rebellious, but how much rebellion is left in me that I need to lean in and give to Jesus? How much rebellion is left in me that wants to redefine God into my image? How much rebellion is in me that chooses to want to be hostile to others so that I can play God in their lives? Listen, before we go any further and you go, oh, man, I'm sure glad this ain't happening today. Look at our world. Look at the church. God, look at us. I'm going to tell this story because I never said this story, but let me just tell you. I felt so much shame when I ended up in a drunk tank. You got to catch this. This is Santa Clara County. I have 2 years of theological training under my belt. My stomach is perforated. I have a doctor with halitosis and bad breath breathing down my neck telling me, Mr. Soto, you're bleeding in your stomach. And I got a guy who's on the other side of the tank who thinks he's Pontius Pilate talking to invisible Jews. I come home. It was the one time that my wife challenged me, and she said, I can't live this way. I've told you that part of the story. Let me tell you the devastating part of the story that I can't get out of my mind, and I'm deeply grateful for the grace of God and people. I didn't know how to stop drinking. I didn't know if I was capable of stop drinking. So Valerie says, go talk to our pastor. Our pastor is a good man. He loves God. He just didn't know how to deal with these things. He looked at me, and here's his exact counsel to me. You're a mess. You have issues. You can forget ministry. I don't know what to do with you. I left there. I left there saying, God, if you are merciful, take me now. And then all of a sudden, a friend calls me. And then the journey kicks off. And another man says, I've been praying for you, Al. And the greatness of the body of Christ with people that I didn't even know were there began to surround me and say, Al, I can walk this journey out with you. This is the reason why you don't have to behave before you belong. This is the reason why we talk about reaching wide. This is the reason why this is a place of hospitality for all of those that are wanting to respond to the good news. Because we don't play pin the tail on your dysfunction or my dysfunction. We're just here to say, I've got dysfunction and I got sin and I need to lean into Jesus. And I remember that moment and I remember how I felt. And I said, not under my watch. And that's the reason why. We need to be a people that says, let's not vaccinate people with a mild dose of Christianity is to protect them from the real thing. Let's be the real deal, huh? Let's be the real deal. The solution to a messed up culture isn't to make non-Christians live like Christians. It is to introduce everyone to Jesus. It is Jesus who's the center focus. It's Jesus who's the transforming power, the one true Savior. He is the only reconciling power in the cosmos. There is no other name that has the power to transform but Jesus Christ. Thirdly, our culture does not need words about grace. It needs people who embody and live out the good news of grace. They embody it. We live it out. Now the law came in to increase the trespass. But where sin increased, what abounded more? So that as sin reigned in death, grace might reign through the righteousness leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Write this down. If God engages us with dignity and with the dignity that he's given us to create us in his image, and yes, he lovingly will turn us over to something, because at times when we have crossed a boundary, he'll say, let this teach you and become your teacher, but he never lets up on us. He continues to work. He'll say, you know what? I get the fact that you're wanting to go on your own, but I'm going to continue to do my work in you. And this is the reason why our world needs the message of the good news. The more grounded I am in the truth, acknowledging my own brokenness and my need for Jesus to deal with my sin, the more broadly I can love like Jesus. This might shock you. Your pastor's got sin. When I'm in the Spirit, you can't see it, but I have my moments. I've told you I got a justice issue. There are times I'd love to take justice in my own hands. There's times I'd love, even with some of the people I pastor, tell them what I really feel. That'd be redemptive. Am I the only one that has those feelings?
No, sir.
Thank you. And I'm not looking to justify anything. Charles Spurgeon said, if you're going to preach the cross, go to the cross. Feel the wood of the cross. Al, he's talking metaphorically, yeah. But he's also talking spiritually. See, the only reason why I can experience 40 years of marriage, the only reason why, is because Jesus Christ is the center of it. In my flesh, there's nothing good. Oh, no, Al, you're a real good person. No, you don't understand me. I know me. Not the smiling Pastor Al that's out there that greets you. There's a brokenness in me that Jesus had to deal with a long time ago, and he's still dealing with it. And the reason why I'm being that honest is today online, and we're dealing with a diverse community. We have people who have same-sex attraction. We have people here that have kids that are battling through that. And on my watch, I'm going to tell you this. We're going to stand with those families. We're going to love. And in any way we can, we're going to pray and be a support to them. And we're not going to abandon them and use them as a punchline, like somehow, well, you're on your own. That's not the scripture. All unrighteousness. And I wonder if today I just go, hey, listen, what's the most recent thing that you wouldn't want anybody to know about? Write it on a piece of paper. Now share it with somebody. Oh, not me. Can we be that honest? But the truth is, whatever you wrote on the paper, guess what? As a believer in Christ, boom, we put it right on the cross. Now hear this, preacher. We are grounded in truth. I told you what our covenant is about marriage. I told you what we believe in. I told you what our covenant is about human sexuality. Now, I don't police it. Our staff doesn't police it. We're not going to give you all of a sudden a survey that said, okay, this week, who blew it, who didn't, on any sin. All I know is there is a grace that as we lean into the good news of Jesus, all unrighteousness needs to be laid at the foot of the cross. And that he becomes the propitiation. He lifts our sin, and he does something that we could not do. And this preacher believes in this wholeheartedly. I don't understand what the fall did and everything it did. I just know everything's broken. And I know that there is a spirit that says I have to live with restraint and boundaries as God the Father creates them. I'm not here to debate it. I'm not here to argue over it. Because I got to live under the same thing as everybody else. That's grace. If it wasn't the case, we would have chaos. Because our appetites can go places, and we've learned that from this passage and what happened in Rome and Greece. And by the way, when Paul was writing this, he wasn't saying that it's getting bad, you Romans. It's already bad. And how many of you say our culture's already at the place of cracking? It is. But the thermostat is the church. And I believe that as we find a foundation in Romans that grounds us in the truth, we can love like Jesus, and the power of Christ can do only what it can do in every life. Amen. And that's it. And I'm deeply grateful that this message is over. Jesus, Jesus, I don't understand a lot of things, God. I understand this. I understand that you came, you died, you're buried, and on the third day you rose. I understand that we have a propensity in our world and our culture when we distance ourselves from you. All kinds of idolatry can take place and we can worship all kinds of things, even our own intellect. We could see ourselves so smart that maybe even smarter than you. And Lord, I just ask that we would become a people that are humble and that we would search your word and that we would understand that all unrighteousness needs to come to the foot of the cross. Lord, I pray that in the area of every area of our life, our mouth, our tongue, our bodies, that we can be a living sacrifice to you, holy and acceptable. And for those who may have failed, and maybe right now they're kind of going, oh man, I've blown it, or God, listen, let those words just stop in their minds and let them know that there is a God that right now in this moment, as they lean into you, from this moment on, we can walk in a way that just honors you one step at a time. You don't ask that we figure it out in our heads. You ask us to respond with our hearts. And I pray that we can respond to our hearts in faith, saying, you're it. So Jesus, I pray that you would have your way today. And I'm going to ask this question, that if there be anyone that would say, I don't know Jesus Christ, I don't have a personal relationship with him this morning, I'm just going to ask if you could just look me in the eyes. I want to pray with you. But if you're here and you go, I don't know Jesus, I'd like to invite you to come to know the Lord Jesus Christ this morning. It could be your first time. But if that's you, just to look me and say, I'm not going to ask you to do anything, but I'm going to pray for you. That's it. Just pray for you. Yeah. 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 Jesus, you see these eyes. Lord, I ask that, and I'm just going to pray this prayer, and under your breath, you can pray this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I've come to the place that I can't live on my own. You died on the cross for my sins. I surrender to that. I here and now make you my Lord and Savior. I ask that you come into my life, that you make me brand new, and in Jesus' name, your spirit would empower me to live after you, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. By the way, I just want to say this. About seven of you looked up to pray that prayer, and if you prayed that under your breath, thank God you know Jesus Christ today. There is no ritual. There's no form. There will be people up here. We will greet you. We will pray with you. We will get you started on your journey. God bless you, Bayside.
Amen. So hope is a gift that we have to share. It's a gift. The good news of Jesus Christ. And so I want to encourage you, if you're here, maybe some of us need to embrace that hope ourselves. Beyond accepting Christ as Savior, maybe some of us need hope. And so if there's something you're struggling with, if you'd like prayer, we'll have some of the elders in our church. They will be up here in the front. They would love to pray with you. And I want to encourage you, if you have accepted Christ, do come up and talk to somebody and get one of our gift bags to get your journey started. And if you're online, text us. We've put that slide up. You can find it again. Search for it online. We would love to connect with you because hope is a gift that we have to share. So God bless you all. Have a great week.